welcome and Merry Christmas. My name is Will Zan. I hope you've had a great Christmas so far. I'm the senior minister here at Haygood United Methodist Church.
And Merry Christmas. My name is Ashley. I work with children and families here at Haygood, and I hope you've had a wonderful season and week with your family. Yeah.
We have our Candler intern, Katie Dean, preaching today, so we're very excited that she has an opportunity to deliver God's word for us. I also want to remind you of just a couple things. One is that New Year's is on the way. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Let's shake off 2020 and begin the new year. And one of the ways that we do that here at Haygood is we develop a star word. A star word is a word that guides you throughout the year. A lot of people make resolutions, but we like to make star words to guide us, like the wise men use that star to guide them to Jesus at Epiphany, that first Sunday in January. We need a star word to guide us the whole year, so be thinking about yours. Also, I want you to know that we are coming up on the end of the financial year as well here at Haygood, and I want to first off say thank you for your generosity. In some challenging times in the midst of COVID, you have given graciously to this church. If you'd like to make an end-of-the-year gift, you can still do so. You can do that online. There's also some instructions on our website if you'd like to give by stock or check. But most off, I want you to know how much we appreciate your generosity. We are in a good, healthy place. And if you'd like to make an end-of-the-year gift, that would go certainly to our mission and ministries here, and we would greatly appreciate it.
Welcome to worship.
Welcome to worship.
As we continue in worship, I invite you to use the words of the Apostles' Creed to affirm your faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
join me in prayer. Gracious God, we thank you for this Christmastide. We thank you that Jesus has come to be our Savior. All glory to you and to He who became incarnate, who became like us to redeem us. We are filled with awe in this season. Fill us with your joy. Lord, we pray for all those who are affected by this pandemic, all the sick. We ask you to pour out the healing power of your Holy Spirit upon them. We ask that you pour out a special blessing upon those who are tending to them in this time of their need. Help us to focus on what we can do to help. Help us to fear not, as the angel said, but help us to follow Jesus in awe of his coming to earth, but filled with his teachings in the years he was with his disciples. May he be with us still. May we do the good work that he called us to do. May we be the salt, the light, and the leaven. May those around us know our joy and feel your power. And may to you be all the glory. We ask this in the name of he who came, he who died for us, and in the words he taught us, we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us, Lord, from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Hey friends, it's Miss Caroline and James and John, and joy to the world. The Lord has come. So today is the Sunday after Christmas, and we hope you had a wonderful Christmas at your house. Did you guys have a good Christmas?
Yes.
You did? Good. So this week in the Bible stories, so after Jesus was born, there were stars in the sky, remember? The bright star? Mm-hmm. And that led the shepherds and the wise men to come visit Jesus. Now we are still several days away from the wise men arriving. We celebrate that day on January 6th, which is called?
Epiphany.
Epiphany, very good.
Yeah, Epiphany.
So I think the main part of the message this week is that all are welcome to come visit Jesus. We don't have a shepherd at this time of filming to demonstrate. He's probably off with Spider-Man. But we do want to let you know that everyone is welcome in the manger. You know, everyone from Transformers to Spider-Man to dinosaurs. You know, we are all welcome to celebrate Jesus. He came for us all, didn't he?
Yeah.
All right. Well, let's say a prayer. Dear God,
thank you
for sending your son to save us all. We love you. Amen. Amen. Merry Christmas.
As we continue in worship, we've come to a time for our offering. Friends, I'd like to invite you to think about all the things that you've been blessed with and how you might be a blessing. We do believe here at Haygood, we are blessed to then be a blessing. You can drop off a check here at Haygood or give online, but I invite you to really think about what God might be calling you to do during this season. So let us pray. Dear Lord, thank you so much for all the ways that you've blessed us. May you help us to understand how we might be a blessing. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Thank you. dumb will speak the praises of the Lamb. Oh, Mary, did you know that your baby boy is Lord of all creation? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will someday rule the nations? Did you know that your baby boy was heaven's perfect lamb? This sleeping child you're holding is the great I Am.
Our scripture this morning begins in the second chapter of Luke with the 22nd verse. When the time came for their purification, according to the law of Moses, they brought him up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every firstborn male shall be designated as holy to the Lord. And they offered a sacrifice according to what is stated in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. This man was righteous and devout, looking forward to the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit rested on him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Messiah. Guided by the Spirit, Simeon came into the temple, and when the parents brought the child, Jesus, to do for him what was customary under the law, Simeon took him up in his arms and praised God, saying, "Master, now you are dismissing your servant in peace, according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people Israel." And the child's father and mother were amazed at what was being said about him. Then Simeon blessed them and said to his mother Mary, "This child is destined for the falling and the rising of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be opposed, so that the inner thoughts of many will be revealed, and a sword will pierce your own soul too." There was also a prophet, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel, of the tribe of Asher. She was of a great age, having lived with her husband for 7 years after her marriage, then as a widow to the age of 84. She never left the temple, but worshiped there with fasting and prayer night and day. At that moment she came and began to praise God and to speak about the child to all who were looking forward to the redemption of Jerusalem. When they had finished everything required by the law of the Lord, they returned to Galilee, to their own town of Nazareth. The child grew and became strong, filled with wisdom, and the favor of God was upon him. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
And the glory.
There was a little boy in the hospital at Christmas time. Now, the nurses did their very best to distract the kids from the fact that they were in the hospital at Christmas. The hospital staff would go around to all the rooms and ask the kids what they wanted for Christmas. Most asked for toys, stuffed animals, clothes. But this little boy simply asked for a balloon. Confused, the hospital staff suggested gift ideas that the boy might be interested in, but he insisted that all he wanted for Christmas was a balloon. As Christmas drew nearer, the hospital staff started to feel bad that they were getting all of these presents for the other kids and nothing for this little boy. But the boy seemed content, so they let it go. When Christmas came around, they delivered the gifts, and all of the children were so excited about their new gifts. And then they walked into the little boy's room, unsure how he would react, and handed him a single balloon. He took it with a huge smile on his face. He then proceeded to get out of bed, put on his slippers, and walk outside. Curious, the hospital staff followed. Once the little boy was outside, he let go of the balloon. And as he watched it float away, he proclaimed, "Happy birthday, Jesus." I love that story. This little boy recognized that the greatest gift at Christmas isn't toys or stuffed animals, even though we all love those things. This gift doesn't light up or make fire truck noises. You can't wear it or play with it. It doesn't come from a store. It's not wrapped in shiny wrapping paper with a big bow. It's not placed under a tree. Instead, this gift is wrapped in cloth and placed in a manger. This is the greatest gift we could receive at Christmas, a gift of love and hope, a light when all else seems dark, a gift from God. As I was reading and rereading this week's scripture, trying to come up with a sermon, I kept thinking of gift-giving and product descriptions. And I know it sounds a little weird, but stick with me, it'll all make sense. When a company is trying to sell you something, they list all the benefits of the product. For example, the Elsa Barbie doll lights up and sings "Into the Unknown" from Frozen 2. Or the Baby Yoda operation game allows you to operate on and save Baby Yoda's life. Or the air fryer, for all the adults out there, prepares ready-to-go French fries, fried chicken, and burgers with ease. Every item that you buy And every gift that you receive has a product description. Like products, we also describe people by what they do or who they are. For example, Will Zant is the senior pastor at Haygood. Or Wally Rice, who cares very deeply about the people that he serves. Or Ashley Brookins, who is super down to earth and open. In our scripture today, we encounter a man named Simeon. Now, Simeon was a righteous and devout man, and he was guided by the Holy Spirit. The Spirit brought Simeon to the temple at the same time as Jesus' purification, so that he might see the Messiah. As soon as Simeon saw the child Jesus, he embraced him and he proclaimed, "For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people, Israel." Simeon describes Jesus as a light, a gift of salvation for all people, not just the Jews. Not just the Gentiles, not just Mary and Joseph. Jesus is a gift to all. No one is excluded from this gift of Christ. Even Anna, who sits at the temple day after day, changes her routine so that she might tell all who pass by about the Messiah. And Simeon tells us exactly what this gift will do for us. This gift will provide salvation. This gift, this little child, Jesus, will bring forth the falling and rising of Israel. Jesus will be a light for revelation, a guide when we are lost and confused. I participated in the Advent study Incarnation by Adam Hamilton. And at one point, he shares a story about a young man asking him if he sees God in the world around him. Today, thousands of years after the birth of Jesus, it may be difficult for some of you to see Jesus around you. But this is what Adam Hamilton says. "When I picture what God is like, God's character, love, mercy, and grace, I see Jesus. I see him loving broken people, eating with sinners and tax collectors. I see him healing the sick and restoring vision to those who were blind. I see him touching the lepers who were treated as untouchables and restoring them to the community by healing their affliction. I think of the compassion he showed to the prostitute who wept at his feet. I think about the Jesus who cast out demons from those who were mentally ill or plagued by forces greater than themselves." Very fitting for our current circumstances, don't you think? I also asked some of my friends and family for a word or sentence that they think of when they think of Jesus, and I want to share a few of those with you today. Jesus is a wonderful counselor. Jesus is a compassionate friend who understands. Jesus is a helper. Jesus is a revolutionary healer. Jesus is the least, the last, and the lost. And this last one, Jesus is love. At its deepest, most truthful meaning, it's a love that transcends all understanding of love. It's raw, it's constant, it's unconditional, it's discipline. It's comfort. It's personal. In a world that sees a lot of darkness and injustice, Jesus provides hope. Jesus is a gift of love. God loves us so much that he gave us his only son. This type of love moves mountains and divides oceans. It breaks down the power of evil and sin. It heals the sick and raises people from the dead. It turns water into wine. God's love is powerful, and nothing can separate us from the power of God's abiding love. It reminds us that we are never alone. It gives us the strength to continue day after day. It gives us the courage to wipe away the tears and get up off the floor. It gives us the bravery to ask for help. Jacob D. Myers, in his book, Making Love with Scripture, reflects on God's love in four different ways. First, the love that we receive from God is something that exists inside us. It is not a mark on our skin or a symbol on our clothes. It dwells in our very souls. Second, this love has the power to form community. It connects individuals from all walks of life, like Simeon and Anna. Third, love defines our way of being in the world. Love is freedom and boldness. Love is selfless, like Jesus. Fourth, love is the supreme form of power in the world. This love is both wonderful and shocking. It is a force stronger than death, nature, or human intelligence. This love is beyond imagination, and it calls us to walk the path of Christ. It shows us how to care for others. The love we receive from God cannot be kept a secret. This love is like water that we hold in our hands, sufficient enough to nourish us, but impossible to contain. The greatest commandment is love, and the church is called to be a community of love and spread the gift of Jesus Christ. When we follow Jesus, we embark upon a path of love, the path of service, the path of listening. Love illuminates our path and casts light on our neighbors in need. Jacob D. Myers states that love is first and foremost listening. He goes on to explain that if we really want to love and serve our neighbor, we must first listen. We must listen to the cries of oppression and injustice of all people, even if it challenges us. We must listen to the cries of those from different sexual, gender, racial, ethnic circumstances. And after we've listened and understood, then we respond in service. God listened to the cries of God's people, and he responded by giving the gift of Jesus. Jesus was sent to serve and give life to the least of these, and we are called to do the same. We are called to pass on the gift of God's love. We are called to be like Simeon and Anna, who share the gift of Jesus to all people who pass by. I encourage you to take a step of faith and recognize those in need around you, and to give back what God has so graciously given you. This has been a hard year. It has been filled with loss, grief, mourning, loneliness, uncertainty. Some days it's been really hard to see the light at the end of the tunnel or the silver lining. In a world that sees so much darkness, so much hate, so much division, I encourage you to be the love, be the light, be Be the spreader of joy and hope and peace. Be the hands and feet of Jesus. Tell people about the gift of Jesus Christ, the power of salvation. Proclaim the gospel to all who need to hear it. We are called to follow Jesus, Emmanuel, and in doing so, incarnate his love and presence to others. We are called to go in his name and be love incarnate to all people. Maybe this could be your New Year's resolution. Maybe you've already started. Maybe you've been doing this your whole life, but I encourage you to give the gift of love. You can do this in a variety of ways. You can serve at a food pantry or a clothing closet. You can write letters to the elderly in nursing homes who feel alone and isolated right now. You can participate in an angel tree. You can write a check to In-Town Collaborative Ministries. You can increase your givings to Haygood. The possibilities are extensive. I encourage you to recognize your gifts and your talents and apply them to service. I encourage you to simply listen. Listen with an open heart and an open mind, to be a presence, a symbol of love. Jacob D. Myers ends his book with a prayer that I want to finish with. He writes, "My hope and prayer for you is that the love of God would guide you and keep you, that God's love would open you fully to human and non-human others, that the word of God revealed in and through Scripture would cause love to stir up within you, and that Jesus Christ, love incarnate, would bless you as you journey with him in love." So happy birthday, Jesus, and thank you. Amen. May the love of God be your guide. May it be your strength. May it be a reminder to you that you are not alone. And may it give you the courage to serve others. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Amen.
King of Kings.